Mount St. Helens continues to surprise scientists. She rumbles and gurgles and gives off clues, but frankly, the mountain speaks a foreign language. Scientists would like to learn to translate volcano fluently. Now they can take their lessons up close. It's safer to walk in the crater because 3 years of eruptions have come to an end.
We're at the mouth of the crater and we're standing right in front of about a 100-foot high wall of the west arm of the glacier. It's the glacier that was bulldozed and pushed aside and that's flowed down and is encroaching on us even as we speak. So the glacier is one of the few glaciers that's advancing rather than retreating. It is moving forward very rapidly. It's the youngest glacier in North America.
Even as the depths of the volcano have gone silent, the new glacier in the very mouth of the crater continues to talk.
Right now, I think the most dramatic thing in the crater is what we're looking at.
John Pallister has been studying Mount St. Helens vocabulary since 1986 for the US Geological Survey. He and his colleagues got a sudden wake-up in October of 2004. Mount St. Helens roared back to life, spewing ash to 15,000 feet in the air. Then, over the course of 3 years, it put on an astounding show of force. Day after day, month after month, new magma shoved its way out of the earth. A new dome was forming, twice as fast as the dome that came up in the late 80s. Now the eruptions are over, and John can pay attention to something other than the massive new dome.
There are blocks of rock that are transported on the surface of the glacier, basically rock slides that came down off the crater walls. They got interlayered with the ice. So we're standing here, 100 meters or so from the glacier front. The reason we're not standing right up there is occasionally one of those big blocks will come down rapidly and without warning, and we don't want to be right there.
In little more than 3 years, the glacier has doubled in thickness. Ice now looms 10 stories tall.
We're dealing with rates of motion that are 10 times what you would see at even a fast-moving glacier somewhere else.
John expects the glacier to advance several hundred feet farther downhill in the next year. It would continue a trend that their aerial photographs have modeled in vivid detail. The glacier's arms have been reaching out farther and farther. In 2008, the arms met. Crater Glacier is now a donut, completely encircling the old and new domes.
5 years ago, if you were standing right here, you would be looking up, instead of seeing a glacier in front of us, you would be looking up at the lava dome from 1980 to 86. And in fact, from here, we could have walked right up to the face and climbed the lava dome. No longer, there's now a glacier in the way.
Unlike most glaciers in the world, this one is growing because rock and ash fall on it so often it insulates it and prevents the ice from melting. It has grown so quickly, in fact, scientists have had to move sensitive instruments out of the way.
We watched it move forward. It overran our Yellow Rock seismic station. We went in, we plunked it out, we moved it out further down on the flats out here in front.
There's one station, a quarter mile away, that's safe from the encroaching glacier, at least temporarily. Seismologist Seth Moran, a USGS earthquake expert, arrives to inspect one of the most sensitive sensors anywhere on Mount St. Helens.
This has been our most problem-free seismic site for the last 2 years. Pretty much every other site that we've had running at St. Helens since 2006 has gone off for one reason or another, but this one's been pretty bulletproof.
Seth discovers one solar panel could not withstand projectiles of pumice flying at glass-shattering speed.
There's an impact point up here, and there's another impact point here, so it looks like we had a couple of pieces of pumice get lifted off in one of the big windstorms and hit this panel.
The solar panels power a seismometer they've buried inside a weatherproof box they call the vault. 24 hours a day, it's on alert, listening to what the mountain and the glacier have to say.
This has been remarkably dependable. It gets a lot of snow, a lot of wind, but it's not had an outage in two entire years.
The environment in the crater is so harsh, scientists never know what kind of damage they'll find.
This is just laying on the ground now. Solar panel shattered. And there's nothing I could do about that, but I could...
Watch the extraordinary lengths they go to in this brutal environment. They haul in heavy construction equipment load by load by helicopter to give their sensors a fighting chance of survival in an extreme environment full of wind, ice, and avalanches of rock.
What we usually do when we can get out of the helicopter and it's safe for us to do this is we dig a hole, bury the seismometer in a hole, and then we sink a mast, sometimes put cement as sort of a root ball to hold the mast in place, and then put a solar panel or put an antenna on that mast.
Few people outside the agency realize just how frequently the scientists have gone into the crater, even during the recent eruption years. They even installed equipment on the constantly changing spine of an actively growing dome. Sometimes, it's just too risky. That's when they resort to their most famous invention. The Spider is a homemade box full of sensors and batteries that a helicopter can snag and sling in where humans dare not go. Their efforts have paid off. No matter what the conditions are, scientists can still visit the crater without ever leaving the office in Vancouver.
From this desktop, you don't have to get your parka on or your gloves or anything, and you can make your measurements from afar.
Steve Schilling can fly through the crater and track the growth of the glacier and the dome over time.
This has been incredible to see a dome split apart a glacier and essentially shove it aside. It's just been spectacular to watch.
It's not just a cool video game. The renditions are precise enough for scientists to take accurate measurements without actually going into the crater.
It gave us an idea to see what's going on at the surface and actually make measurements, not just to observe it and look at it, which was important, but also to be able to tell people how high is the dome.
They've managed to plot the source of most of the big quakes, too. Every dot is an earthquake over magnitude 3. The computers in their office are evolving just as quickly as the technology they deploy in the crater. They've seized the power of infrared cameras to see just how hot the spines are when that fresh magma surges from the depths of the earth.
What it allows us to do is to have some viewpoints that we've never had before.
The technology has become so precise, they've picked up one change no one could have noticed just a few years ago. As that massive new dome came up over 3 years, the home of the nearby visitor center, Johnston Ridge, actually sank. Just a little.
Johnston Ridge has sunk very, very small amount. You're talking about millimeters. As you remove mass in one place, the surrounding region has to compensate, so the flanks go down as the summit goes up.
It is in their measurements that the scientists try to deduce what Mount St. Helens will tell us next. The dome that provided such sudden dramatic change appears mute now. On the other hand, Crater Glacier seems as noisy as ever.
If the rate continues at the rate it was going last year, then by next year, we will have glacier where I'm standing right now. You know, we say the eruption has stopped, but it could well resume. It only takes a little bit of a change in that magmatic pressure to turn this thing on and off. So we'll have to wait to see.